think about the generations and to say we want to make it a better place for our children and our children's children so that they know it's a better world for them and think if they can make it a better place.
Mr. Ian Crane, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Simon. Okay, I probably should have called this talk tonight something like, "Is this for real?" Because when I first started introducing this subject to people, their reaction was, "Oh, don't be so stupid, they're not going to do anything like that." And I said, well, you know, believe it or not, that's exactly what they want you to think. And I had one of these conversations, and the next day I was doing some research, and I pulled up a document from the National Health Federation. And you're going to hear about this organization during the course of my talk tonight. And the opening paragraph here, it says, "Never heard of Codex? That's exactly what they want. The Codex agenda." And we'll expand on this through the evening. "The Codex agenda, only low potency supplements available that will do nothing for your health, all or most foods genetically modified, and any beneficial supplements unavailable or sold only by prescription." Which is, by the way, exactly the way it is in Norway right now. And certain other countries are further down the road. But the key point here is, never heard of Codex? That's exactly what they want. So what I'm going to do tonight is basically put you on the spot. Because after tonight, you have to walk away from here and you have to make a decision. And it's going to be a very fundamental decision. And when I show you what's coming, I think you'll understand why it's an important decision. But let me start by introducing you to this guy here, Mark Plotkin. I first came across this guy, well, his books anyway, when I was doing some research in Central America about 10 years ago. And I read a book of his called The Shaman's Apprentice. And Plotkin is a Harvard graduate, and he went on a trip, basically his first trip to the Amazon was just as a gopher. He just fancied a break during his summer vacation, so he managed to finagle his way onto the trip as a sort of bag carrier. But he was so fascinated by that trip that he decided that he actually wanted to change his course of study and actually study ethnobotany. So he went back into the Amazon a couple of years later, but this time on a different mission. And his mission was to go deep into the Amazon jungle and make contact with a tribe that had had almost no contact with the outside world. This took quite a while to set up, but he did this. And what he discovered there absolutely blew his mind. Because what he discovered was a culture that was really totally unspoiled by the Western world. Basically, the people basically ran around naked. I mean, the only dress was that the men had a little piece of string around their waist. And after a few days, he realized that this string actually had a purpose. Because when these guys were hunting in the jungle, they used this piece of string to tuck a certain appendage out of the way so they didn't catch when they were jumping over the trees and the branches in the forest. But that was it. But what fascinated him was their medicines. And the fact that the shaman, the medicine man, you know, basically was this repository of information that had been handed down generation after generation. And each shaman, as they reached a certain point in their life, would identify an apprentice within the tribe. And it would be the responsibility of the shaman to pass on that information and that knowledge to the apprentice. But Plotkin put the effort in to learn about the work of the shaman. And what he realized was that these guys had medicines, natural medicines, natural potions that they were mixing together that basically cured their diseases and their illnesses. And they really, you know, had a very long life expectancy. So he actually made notes of this and took that information back to LA. And to fund his trips to the Amazon, he sold that information that he had picked up to a pharmaceutical company. Well, he went back to the Amazon. He went back up to meet that same tribe 4 years later. And when he came up to the landing stage on the river, first of all, what shocked him was these guys came down to meet him in cut-off Levi's and Hawaiian shirts. Gone was the string around the waist. But then what he saw next threw him into a rage, because he went into the shaman's hut, and gone were, you know, all the vases of the local herbs and the local plants for making the medicines, and they were replaced with rows of bottles from the pharmaceutical companies. And when he looked closely, he realized that some of these medicines were the synthetics that had been created from the information that he'd given the pharmaceutical company sold to the pharmaceutical company 4 years previously. And he asked the shaman why it was that they were using these medicines, and he said, well, the missionaries told us that to use our natural medicines is the work of the devil, and that we have to use these bottled medicines. Well, I encourage you to read this book. It's still available, The Shaman's Apprentice. He actually goes very easy on the missionaries. I mean, one would expect, based on his experience, for him to be a little harsher. But he tries to go a little easy. The book, The Shaman's Apprentice, was actually turned into a film as well, which is also available on DVD. But this is the quote that struck me. Every time a shaman dies, it's as if a library burned down. Well, being a student of ancient traditions, and the passage of ancient wisdom, of course, the realization this isn't the first time that we've seen this type of situation. I mean, the same people who were pushing the synthetic medicines on the tribes, you know, have the same belief system as those who burned down the Library of Alexandria in 415, who burned thousands upon thousands of books under the leadership of Bishop Diego de Landa in the 16th century in Central America. And of course, actually, they're doing it right now in Baghdad with the destruction of the Baghdad Museum and the special forces that are going out into ancient Sumer and trying to hunt down any of the ancient texts, just in case there's anything there that contradicts their belief system that they wished to put out to the masses. But Plotkin recognized that basically here we have a situation where knowledge that had been handed down for millennia was being wiped out in a heartbeat. The pharmaceutical industry fundamentally is about 80 years old. 80 years old. And then look on the other side. This is a book that's just been published by William Engdahl. It's called Seeds of Destruction: The Hidden Agenda of Genetic Manipulation. And I'm just going to read you a review. It's a review written by a friend of mine in Canada, because this book is hot off the press, so I haven't read it myself. But his review, he says, this skillfully researched book focuses on how a small socio-political American elite seeks to establish control over the very basics of human survival. The provision of our daily bread. Control the food and you control the people. This is no ordinary book about the perils of GMO. Engdahl takes the reader inside the corridors of power, into the back rooms of the science labs, behind closed doors in the corporate boardrooms. The author cogently reveals a diabolical world of profit-driven political intrigue, government corruption and coercion, where genetic manipulation and the patenting of life forms are used to gain worldwide control over food production. This is just the tip of the iceberg. Gordon Brown has thrown his hat into the arena with this constant reference to the New World Order, a phrase that had never crossed his lips until January the 15th of this year. And he was actually in India when he read a speech, rather haltingly, I think, actually. But this was the first time that he mentioned the phrase New World Order. Tony Blair had only mentioned this phrase a couple of times, and both of those occasions were in the immediate aftermath of 9/11. And Gordon Brown gave a speech at the CBI, the Confederation of British Industry, in May of this year, six weeks before he was sworn in as the unelected Prime Minister of this country. And in that speech, he mentions the phrase New World Order no fewer than nine times. New World Order is very, very significant. Because New World Order, I mean, George Orwell wrote a book, most people know him from 1984, very few people know the book that he wrote in 1938 called The New World Order. An extremely prescient book, arguably even more prescient than 1984. Hitler, of course, used the phrase New World Order. Hitler's primary financial backers were the pharmaceutical industry, IG Farben, which was effectively the conglomerate of the three major German pharmaceutical companies, which is Herxt, Bayer, and BASF. The CEOs of those companies were charged at Nuremberg and were convicted of war crimes. Most people think of Auschwitz as a concentration camp. What most people don't know is that Auschwitz was the largest work camp ever known. It was 5 miles by 2, so it was like 10 square miles. It was 10 square miles. That was a work camp. And IG Farben were using these people as slave labor, but also, more importantly, more significantly, as tests, as human guinea pigs. And the CEOs were jailed after the war. But within 10 years, two of the senior players in IG Farben were back at the helm of two of the major German pharmaceutical companies, Herxt and BASF. Shouldn't be any surprise to anybody that the pharmaceutical industry is the most significant financial backer of the Bush regime. So Gordon Brown has made it very clear that, you know, he is absolutely signed up to the agenda of the New World Order. And we're going to look at some of the aspects of that agenda. Globalization is definitely a key aspect. And we see this coming down the tracks. And most people really have no concept about what's coming. Because the powers that be, just as they don't want you to know what the detail of Codex is all about, they don't want you to know about the detail of the political agenda because it's a little sensitive. So, after the Second World War, this is what the map of Europe would have looked like. Well, 27 different nations represented there, all responsible for their own, effectively, internal policy, philosophy, lifestyle. But, of course, since 1957 and the establishment of the Club of Rome, which was initially an economic cooperation or economic cooperative organization, but it has grown into a 27-nation superstate. And right now, a governor of a state in the U.S. has more power, more autonomy, than a prime minister of a European nation. There is more federal law in Europe than there is in the U.S. And Europe as a federation has been around for exactly 51 years, or 50 years and 6 months, isn't it? March 15th, 1957. It's been around for exactly, 50 years, and there is more federal legislation than the US, which has been around for, 231? But this is only the start of things to come, because whilst Europe has been coming together as a superstate, this has been happening in other areas of the world. We have the League of African Nations, the League of Arab Nations, the Asia-Pacific Economic Community, the Southeast Asia Economic Community, and the one that's coming really fast down the track is the North American Union. This is so imminent, it's being brought about by the collapse of the dollar. You know, interestingly enough, if you look at the graphs, and there was one published in the Independent just a few days ago, and it shows the start of the decline of the dollar at the moment that George Bush was appointed to the White House by the democratic process of the Supreme Court ruling 5-3 in his favor. And that's the start of the decline. We haven't seen the end of it by any stretch of the imagination. The intention is to create the North American Union. And if you think that this is fantasy, it just so happens that once again I picked up the magazine of the Natural Health Federation, Health Freedom News, and the chairman of that organization, who I'll mention later, is a Brit by the name of Paul Anthony Taylor, and his lead article in this edition is The North American Union, an amusing joke or a super government in the making. This guy is one of the lead players on the non-government organization that has rights to participate in the Codex process. So If anybody knows what he's talking about and what he's experiencing, it should be Paul Anthony Taylor. There's another reason, apart from the economic relationship, which is perhaps even more sinister, that the US desperately wants to create the North American Union, and that is because their military is struggling to recruit, funnily enough. So by opening the borders, I don't think they're going to get too many Canadians signing up for the military, but the Mexicans will be streaming across the border. So all of a sudden, this North American Union, which is just the next step on from the North American Free Trade Association, which of course the EU is just the same step beyond the European Economic Community. Once that happens, then they will have a North American army. And what you'll see is that wherever it is that the US wants to pursue its agenda of hegemony, it'll be mainly Mexicans. And I just about mentioned this document in pretty much every one of my talks, and I've been doing this for a number of years, and it's still probably a very underread document. It's called Rebuilding America's Defenses. It's written by an organization called Project for New American Century. This particular document was published in September of 2000. And if you read it, you think that this is like George Orwell on acid. Because it literally talks about, the need for the US to dominate the globe and to do it by any means available, which fundamentally means militarily. It even has a couple of paragraphs on the use of pharmaceuticals to enhance the performance of the military, reducing fear, reducing the requirement for food and water, effectively turning the military into a robotic force. So it shouldn't surprise you that the US military is guilty of so many atrocities, because they're drugged up to the freaking eyeballs. They're not human. They're not having any rational thought process. It's spelt out here. So you read this document and you think, my God, this is the work of some real sick psychopath. But then you turn to the back page and you see it's not the work of one person, it's actually the work of 27, including the likes of Paul Wolfowitz, Donald Rumsfeld, the current head of the World Bank, Zolich, who replaced Wolfowitz, a guy called Rabbi Dov Zakheim, who was the guy who on September the 10th, 2001, announced to the media that the Pentagon could no longer account for $2.3 trillion. Funnily enough, that little comment got lost in the aftermath of the following day. But these guys have spelt their agenda out in words of one syllable in this document. So it shouldn't really be any surprise to what's going on here. And because of their belief system, and I discussed the belief systems in the DVD that I put together called Fool Me Once, but these guys absolutely believe that the more information they put out for people to see, and then they do nothing about, that gives them a mandate. So when we read information, and what I'm going to show you during the course of the evening is a lot of what I'm talking about is actually out there for people to see. But then when we elect to do nothing about it, they then take that as a mandate to pursue their agenda. And they will push, and right now we see them pushing until such point as they'll get civil unrest. And then, they might just sort of back off a tad. So what the next step is going to be is the merger of the American Union with the EU, making it the most powerful economic bloc, obviously, in the world. It will be totally dominant economically, and it will very quickly swallow up all the other trade communities, all under the banner of the United Nations. The symbolism of the United Nations flag is very significant. That grid that's over the top of the world. It's very significant. It's very aggressive looking symbol underneath it. Anybody recognize that symbol? The World Bank. The World Bank. And a book that I would highly recommend to you. By the way, I don't usually bring so much of my research material, but with this particular subject, so many people think that this is just fantasy. I have to bring some material, so that if you want, later on, you can come and have a look for yourselves. But this is a book called The Confessions of an Economic Hitman by a guy called John Perkins, who spent many years working for the World Bank, or for subsidiaries of the World Bank. And his job was to go into developing nations and persuade the governments to buy in to massive credit plans, basically to bring that developing nation government into hock. Because just like on the microcosm, you know, once you've got an individual in serious debt, basically you've got them under control. And the same thing with the macrocosm. If you can get a nation into serious debt, then, you know, you basically have them where you want them. And it shouldn't come as any great surprise to you that there's a very common denominator between all the countries that are classified as the axis of evil. This Bush term. And it's the countries like Cuba, North Korea, Iran, recently Russia. Anybody wondered why Russia has been demonized in the media, basically, for the last 6 months? Well, all of these countries, oh, and Venezuela, of course, and an increasing number of Latin American countries, as Venezuela and Chavez starts to find ways to help these guys out of their debt to the World Bank. These guys, all of these countries that are part of the axis of evil, are free of debt. And Russia paid off its last installment for all the billions that it borrowed after the collapse of the Soviet bloc back in 1990. So Putin had actually done an amazing job by appointing the seven ugly sisters, the seven oligarchs, to manage the industrial recovery. Of course, some of those oligarchs got a little bit too carried away and just wanted a bit too much power, and that's why, you know, Putin has a bit of a problem with one or two of them. But his strategy was absolutely sound, because what he did was he identified the best guys in the country to take their particular industries and bring them, you know, back up to full speed, and obviously enable Russia to become self-sufficient. And Russia's in exactly that position right now. The World Bank has a couple of henchmen to carry out its will, and that is the World Trade Organization, which has been around since 1995, and the World Health Organization. Now, these two organizations are complete misnomers, because let me assure you that the World Trade Organization has nothing really to do with world trade, and the World Health Organization definitely has nothing to do with health. Basically, any country that is signed up to membership of the World Trade Organization is effectively under the auspices of the UN. So anything that the World Trade Organization deems to be law, the member countries have to abide by. And I'll give you one example that you won't be aware of. The World Trade Organization have deemed it quite legitimate for the US to export its hormone-impregnated beef. And it sees no reason why any nation, certainly any member nation, should reject the importation of contaminated beef, i.e. contaminated with the growth hormone. The EU at the moment refuses to import the American beef. So the EU has to pay a fine to the World Trade Organization of 150 million euros a year. Because we don't want their contaminated beef. And that fine will increase. As the EU continues to reject it, then the fine increases until they can, you know, make the pit squeak. And in the end, what they expect you to do is go, okay, we take it. Now, who's going to eat it? Well, but you won't know. Because a big part of Codex is to remove the labeling on foods, as we shall see. Now, the EU, a lot of people are under the misapprehension or misimpression that the EU is a democratic organization. Let me categorically assure you it's not. First of all, I mean, you know, we could get into the debate about whether you can actually mention the two phrases, democracy and a three-line whip, in the same breath. I mean, a three-line whip is not democracy, and that's exactly what we have here. But the EU is even worse. When you elect your MEP,